Hey, welcome back, everybody. I'm just really, really excited about this next presentation. I can't hardly stand still. Did you know that our next presenter is an attorney? Some of you. Not that kind of an attorney. It's not what you think. Danny Sheehan is an attorney with a heart, and I mean a heart as big as this frickin' room. He's an advocate. He's a man that uses his brilliance and his intellect to actually defend good from evil, okay? An advocate, guys, for good. Just a couple of the things that you might know. He was advocate on the Karen Silkwood case and the Pentagon Papers case and the Chicago 7 case and the Three Mile Island case, and it goes on. Did you know our friend Jordan from Rogue Valley Metaphysical Library actually compiled a biography on Danny's advocate work? Guys, it's 17 pages long. True. So I'm going to take you back to 1994, right? And I'm in the board meeting, and I said, okay, now the next person that I want to bring in is an attorney. Whoa, Bob, where are you going? What? Why do you want an attorney? I said, well, guys, listen, he knows stuff. Yeah. I said, did you know that Jimmy Carter actually launched an investigation into the UFO reality? Well, no, I thought he just saw lights in the sky. No, guys, he actually launched an investigation. And it was under the auspices of an official U.S. Library of Congress inquiry. And Danny was the investigation special consultant. And guys, sit down for this. He actually got to read the classified section of Project Blue Book. That exists. Yes. And guys, guess what? Danny took notes. Okay. So that's where it all started, back in 1994. Nobody had any idea that the famous Danny Sheehan had a connection, a deep connection into UFO stuff. But he did. And as they say, the rest is history. So please welcome our very, very favorite advocate of all time, Danny Sheehan.
We'll hug again.
All right. Yeah.
Well, good evening. As Robert said, my name's Danny Sheehan. I've talked with a number of you before, a few times. I've been asked, as Bob mentioned, to come and brief the Congress back in 1994. About the activities that I had engaged in with regard to the Library of Congress Congressional Research Service study that was done back in 1977 at the request of President Jimmy Carter. And you also probably remember me as the attorney that represented Dr. John Mack when Dr. John Mack, the head of the Department of Clinical Psychiatry at Harvard Medical School, had been brought up in front of a special panel of the Harvard University faculty to basically account for his having written a book about the phenomenon of extraterrestrial intelligence and abductions. And that was how I came to be familiar with you over the years. And on a number of occasions, I've been invited to speak again, and had done a report when I was legal counsel for the Disclosure Project back in April of 2001, with Dr. Stephen Greer, and we had brought together some 21 employees, very high-level employees in the United States government, ranging from full lieutenant colonels, one of whom is in the audience here today, in the United States Air Force, others, the chief investigator from the Federal Aviation Agency that investigated a number of UFO sightings, to various officials in different organizations in the government, to come to Washington, to come and meet with members of Congress, to report to the members of Congress from their particular perspective as comparatively credible witnesses, what they knew about this issue of extraterrestrial intelligence in the UFO phenomenon. So that was the one of the other presentations that I made. And then I was asked, I remember one time I was here and I had been here talking with some people about some legal issues that had arisen relating to the publication of Colonel Corso's book here, the day after Roswell, here in the United States. And someone who was on the speaker list failed to appear, and I was asked to fill in and to do a report. And so I basically explained why, on the basis of my some 40 years in the field as a professional attorney and investigator, why it is that I was convinced that the United States national security state would virtually under no circumstances reveal to the American people the information which was held within the national security community about this issue. And so those were the handful of presentations that I have made in the past, but I've been coming to the Congress every chance I could when I wasn't in the midst of a trial or in the midst of some major investigation when the Congress was convened over the period of the last 16 years. So I know many of you, and it's in that context that I know that you know me. But as Bob said, that for the people who will be seeing this presentation only on the videotape, that they will probably remember me better as the one of the attorneys, as Bob pointed out, for the New York Times back in 1971 against the Richard Nixon administration, where we represented the New York Times and established their right in the United States Supreme Court to publish the contents of the Pentagon Papers back in 1971 in June. And I also would be known by the outside world as one of the attorneys that was in F. Lee Bailey's office back in 1973 during the Watergate burglary hearings in front of the Congress, in which we represented James McCord, the former CIA wiretap specialist who was caught in the Watergate Hotel, who we ended up persuading to write the letter to John Sirica blowing the whistle on Richard Nixon and the Plumbers Unit, which led to the impeachment hearings against Richard Nixon and his resignation. And the people will also remember me as the attorney for the Karen Silkwood case, the chief counsel in the Karen Silkwood case, that actually won the largest civil judgment in the history of the United States at that time, and secured the order which stopped the construction of all private nuclear facilities in the United States from 1979 all the way up until now. On the brink of the new announcement that's been made by President Barack Obama that he intends to authorize up to $59 billion to be given in loans and guarantees to the private nuclear power industry to build 33 new power plants, nuclear power plants. So then, of course, the Iran-Contra case. People know me from the history of the Iran-Contra case, of that investigation that we did. But little known to those people who are listening to this on the videotape, and actually little known to even to you, whom I've been with now for some 16 years, there's a third dimension to my previous career, and that is that I was after law school, after completing law school, I ended up returning to Harvard University after having graduated from Harvard College in 67 in the Harvard Law School in 1970. I returned in the fall of 1973 to undertake my master's studies at the Harvard Divinity School in the field of Christian theology and comparative social ethics, and went on to begin my PhD work there at Harvard, and was then invited to become chief counsel to the United States Jesuit orders, national headquarters in Washington, D.C., in their National Social Ministry Office. And it was there in that context that I undertook to attempt to persuade the 54 major religious denominations in the United States to undertake to prepare for the establishment of contact with an extraterrestrial civilization, to try to get that put on their agenda, to have theological and philosophical discussions to prepare the people of our world for this type of an encounter. And it was in that context that I was in fact contacted by Marcia Smith, the head of the Science and Technology Division of the United States Congressional Research Service, shortly after the election of President Carter in 1976 in November. I was contacted later in January of 77 to be a special consultant to the UFO investigation that went on. And in that context, I was invited to present a three-hour closed-door seminar to the top 50 scientists in the SETI program, in the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, on the theological implications of our contact with an extraterrestrial civilization. Now, the particular context in which I have been invited to come tonight to talk with you is the recent convocation that occurred by the Vatican. It's been touched upon briefly, I think, in a couple of the earlier talks that people have given, but specifically between November 4th of 2009 and November 9th, this is now just 1 year following the election of President Barack Obama to establish it in kind of its historical context, the Vatican convened through its Pontifical Academy of Sciences. It convened a five-day conference in Rome, actually at Castel Gandolfo, just outside of Rome, which is the summer residence of the Pope. And it is on the grounds of the Vatican Observatory. And they convened a meeting of some of the top scientists in the world to come together to talk with Vatican officials about the probabilities of the establishment of imminent contact with an extraterrestrial civilization and what its implications would be. And it was in it was immediately following that convocation that went from the 4th of November to the 9th of November, that on November 10th of 2009, just a little more than 100 days ago, as we gather here tonight, a press conference, an unprecedented press conference, was held at the Vatican in its official press room at the Holy See, and it was chaired by a Jesuit priest, Father Jose Gabriel Funes, who is the director of the Vatican Observatory. And at that time, he issued a public statement stating that the time has now arrived at which the Roman Catholic Church is stating that it is time for us to start to identify and to answer the important and profound philosophical and theological questions that are posed to our human family by our contact with an extraterrestrial, intelligent, but non-human species and their civilization. And at that same press conference, the professor of astronomy from the Arizona State University Steward Observatory in Tucson, Arizona, which is a sister observatory to the Vatican Observatory, where many of the Jesuit scientists, priest scientists from the Vatican do their observations and studies. The Professor Christopher Ippi issued a statement at the same press conference at the Vatican on November 10th of 2009, in which he stated, "The discovery of intelligent extraterrestrial life elsewhere in our universe may be only a few short years away, and the implications for our human self-image are going to be profound. It is therefore entirely appropriate that this conference on this special topic be hosted by the Pontifical Academy of Science of the Roman Catholic Church, because both science and religion have come to note the importance of the potential existence of life on other worlds, and so that those of us who study in the field of astrobiology and those of us who study in the fields of philosophy and theology should come together to share our views at this time." Now, many people had assumed that this had been instigated by the recent spate of discoveries that have gone on of new planets. That, as you may know, that the first confirmed existent planet outside of our own solar system was encountered in 1995, and there'd been some dispute as to whether it was really a planet or not. But in the last 10 years, as it turns out, our human family now has, quote, discovered, we've discovered some 373 planets that we've confirmed to be planets. And 13 of them are what they call Earth-like planets, which means that these planets are located in relationship to their respective suns in the galaxy that place them at approximately the same relative distance from their star as our Earth is, so that the degree of sunlight and radiation that they would be receiving is analogous to that which we receive here on our planet. And they have laid out these planets in their relative perspective to their mass and size compared to the Earth along this continuum, which you can see here. And I've blown it up a bit so that you can see the relative sizes of these planets. Some are approximately the same size as our Earth. You can see there are these little red ones. There's one here, three here, one here, three here, one here. And then as you move farther away, there are others that have been identified here and here that are as many as 1,000 light years away. This is 500 light years away. The others are 20 light years away, et cetera. And these planets have now been discovered by our human family. And so many people are starting now to say, in the scientific community, who used to say, well, there's probably not life anywhere else because we haven't discovered any oxygen on any other planets. Well, now they have. They said, well, there's probably not any life because we haven't discovered any water on any other planets. Well, now they have. They've actually discovered water vapor in the atmospheres of a number of these planets through spectroscopic analysis. And so there's been a major sea change in the scientific world, where they've now started to assert that, well, it probably is fairly likely that there is other life in the universe, but it isn't likely that they'd be able to get here because of the barrier that exists, pursuant to which our present state of science tells us that no amount of mass can be accelerated up to or past the speed of light, because as the acceleration takes place, the mass of the object starts to increase exponentially. And so therefore, you would have a barrier against being able to accelerate any amount of material up to or past the speed of light. And given the fact that these stars and planets exist so far away that it'd be impossible, therefore, traveling at more traditional speeds to, in fact, get here. So, but the reality is that now the boundaries of science are pressing on the limitations, and there's beginning to be a series of tests that have been done and experiments that have been done, which are leading people to believe that, in fact, that may not, in fact, be an absolute. And so, therefore, there's a matrix of work that is being done in the scientific field, which is starting to threaten that as a barrier to our being able to have direct contact or communication with these extraterrestrial worlds. Now, I want to say, in just closing my opening remarks on this, that I think that it is extraordinarily important that the Roman Catholic Church has issued this call for the active consideration of the existence of extraterrestrial intelligence and our potential contact with it, in asking the laity and the people who are not in government to attempt to identify what we understand to be the profound philosophical and theological questions that occur to us, and to try to provide answers for them, in my opinion, so as for us to be able to demonstrate ourselves that we are perfectly capable of coming to grips with this reality, because for two reasons. One, no matter how confident we seem to be when we gather here each year in Laughlin for our International UFO Congress, that we believe that there is extraterrestrial life, and some people among us have had direct contact with such life, the substantial experience has been, for people who have had such contact, and for all of those of us who would like to have such contact, the reality is that we all secretly among ourselves suspect that we would be somewhat traumatized by the actual experience of actually coming face to face with an actual extraterrestrial being. And that no matter how confident we'd like to pretend we would be, the fact is that we as a species have bred into us a natural cellular fight or flight response when we encounter something that is so completely alien and so completely unknown to us, that we have an automatic instinctive reaction to be frightened by this, cellularly. The reason for this is quite simple, is that we happen to be the descendants of all of those hominoids who had this faculty, who knew enough to fly, to flee, and to get away from certain things that threatened them. And so therefore, we have this genetic inbred quality within us that causes us to have this kind of completely non-rational, unreflective response, physical reaction to the encountering of something so astonishingly outside of our reality system. And it is because of this particular assertion that we all are going to have this type of fear reaction to the actual experience that the established authorities in our world, both governmental and ecclesial in the religious communities, have in fact felt that it was justified for them to refrain from communicating with us about what it is they understand about both the existence of such an extraterrestrial civilization and the question of whether any of the UFO incidences actually involve vehicles from an extraterrestrial civilization coming to our planet. Because they have this great gap, the great divide between what they know to be true and what it is that they ever say to us, the people. And that is an historical quality or characteristic of the ruling class. It's been true ever since the most primitive authoritarian robber baron chieftains all the way up to the present day with people as sophisticated as Barack Obama. There is no one-to-one relationship between what it is that they come to know and what it is they say to the people. Now, theoretically, in light of the fact that we live in a representative democracy, the theory is that we're supposed to be given access to this information so as to enable us to make decisions about what policies we want to have and what leaders we want to put in to make decisions representatively for us. But the reality is that this isn't true, that even the representatives that we elect and send to Washington every 2 years to 4 years, in fact, harbor the same exact inclination. And so they harbor a deep distrust of us. And they therefore share the information among themselves. And as I pointed out in my presentation, I think in 2001, therefore, I believe that it is absolutely predictable that our leadership, both governmental and ecclesial, would in fact not share this information with us until such time as we as lay people and as non-governmental officials can demonstrate to them that we are capable of asking ourselves the right questions and providing answers that would go together to make up a new worldview that gives access to both the extraterrestrial civilization and accepts our present leadership, both governmental and religious. And as long as we can accommodate the extraterrestrial reality with our present leadership in government and in religious circles, then they will, for the first time, begin to trust us and be open to allowing us to have access to some of the information which they have. Now, what I would like to do in the time that we have together this evening, that I'm actually, as I say, discussing this in the context of my having been the legal counsel at the Jesuit National Headquarters Office of Social Ministry for some 10 years, and a student of theology, that what I want to do is I want to follow a simple 8-step presentation so that we can go at this one step at a time, because as they say, climbing a large mountain looks impossible to most of us who don't do it, but for those that do it, they see it as one step at a time. And as long as you can drive in one pinion and tie yourself down and then drive in another pinion and move up to the next one, you can climb the highest mountain. And so I want us to take this one step at a time. The very first step that I would like to have us take together is I would like to, first of all, I would like to not waste any of our time together continuing the criticisms of the Catholic Church, which are so well deserved. It's quite clear that from their carrying on of the Inquisition to their crusades, to their rationalization of human slavery, of their proselytizing on behalf of imperialism, on behalf of the white European Caucasian race, over all of the indigenous people of the world. We could go on at great length, but I want those 30 seconds to be all we really spend on that issue. To say nothing about the wrath which they deserve because of their more recent sins with regard to the concealment and covering up of the pedophile priests, etc., which we all are way too familiar with, that other people will criticize them for all of those activities, as they should. But let's not waste our time doing that. But I just want it to be clear to you, as a former Jesuit novice on my part and legal counsel for them, that I do not for one second, and never have, lifted a pencil to paper to try to defend any of those types of activities on the part of the Catholic Church. Nor do I want to spend an awful lot of time extolling all of the positive and good things that the Catholic Church or the Christian faith or theology in general have provided as services to our human family. There are others who went all the way through the novitiate and took the oath of office who will do that. So I would like to not spend our time any more on that, but what I would in fact want to do is to, rather than waste our time being antagonists to them, to become protagonists together in the pursuit of this mission that has been green-lighted, as it were, by the Roman Catholic Church, for us as the laity to move into asking ourselves these questions and seeking answers together. Now, in that context, I'll note parenthetically that we are going to, instead of having questions and answers here all together right after the talk tonight, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be convening outside in the big room at the end of the hall, that big space at the end of the hall. We're going to be convening at 7:30 this evening until maybe 9:30, when some of the movies and things are going to be going on. And we'll be doing it this evening and tomorrow evening so that we can talk about this extraordinarily important material about what our philosophical and theological questions are. But step two, I don't want us to spend all of our time caught in the debate as to whether it's true. You know, do we really think that there is in fact an extraterrestrial civilization, or do we in fact think that one or more of the UFO incidents really constitute a vehicle from another planet visiting our planet? I don't want to spend all of our time re-arguing that. And the reality is that a substantial portion of the some 65 years, or 63 years that this debate has been going on most recently, has been devoted to this peculiar argument about whether it's true, because it is such an extraordinary fact, and it lies so firmly outside of the reality structure that has been endorsed to us or for us by the established order, both governmental and ecclesial, as well as academic, that it seemed to have required extraordinary proof to really establish it. So I don't want to waste our time doing that. Instead, what I would like to do is I would like to take as an assumption on the basis of which we will move to identify the philosophical and theological questions and seek to answer them together. Take as established fact the assertion that was made in the 1973 United States Air Force Academy text on physics that they taught at the Air Force Academy, which was called Environmental Space Sciences 2 at the Academy, in which they asserted that there were, in fact, to a virtual certainty, other highly technologically developed intelligent civilizations, non-human civilizations in our galaxy, and that this should be understood by the professional Air Force officers that were being trained at the Air Force Academy as of 1973. And secondly, I want us to take as an assumed fact the findings that were actually made by the United States Congressional Research Service Science and Technology Division in 1977 at the request of President Carter after he came to office, in which they concluded that there is better than a 90% probability that there exist from two to six, at least from two to six, other highly technologically developed non-human intelligent civilizations just inside our Milky Way galaxy. Now that's a fairly conservative estimate given the fact that there are some 500 billion star systems in our galaxy alone, and that there are in fact 500 billion trillion galaxies. So the odds are quite substantial that there are these other civilizations. And if in fact we can, as a human family, come to grips with the reality that the speed of light is not in fact a barrier to the communication with such another civilization, or their coming here or us going there, that I would like us to proceed on the basis of that factual analysis. Thirdly, I would like us to understand, very importantly, that as I mentioned in my 2001, it's essential for us to understand that in the same way that the issue of whether or not extraterrestrial non-human intelligence exists, or whether the UFO phenomenon constitutes contact with another civilization, that those two realities are prismed through each individual's worldview. And I touched upon that back in the 2001 talk, and it's important here as the third step of our analysis to understand that in the same way that the phenomenon is experienced and perceived through the prisms of one's particular worldview, the particular philosophical or theological questions that one asks in response to the discovery that the civilization exists and that we're going to have direct contact with it, those questions that are asked flow from an individual's worldview. And for that reason, I wanted to, as a third step, just to touch upon once again, and I will, what it is that goes into making up a worldview, because the reality is that for 99.9% of us, when we're talking about asking philosophical questions or theological questions, the simple fact is we don't have the slightest idea what we're talking about. I mean, if somebody waxes rather strangely into realms of that we don't normally talk about, they say, well, he was being pretty philosophical about that. But, well, that's not what really philosophy is all about. So what I want to do is I want to identify for us exactly what philosophy is and exactly what theology is and how the two of them are related yet distinct from each other. And in that context, I'll be talking about what the philosophical and theological questions are that would be generated by each of these different worldviews. But rather than spend all of our time rehashing what all of those different worldviews are, I want to tell you very simply that the scientific social psychiatrists and the sociologists have come to the professional academic conclusion that there exists a spectrum of worldviews, but there are not an infinite number of them. That what they have come to conclude is, and I'll briefly point it out to you here, and that is this, and that is that there exist a set of worldviews that they have characterized. This is Professor Talcott Parsons. Professor Talcott Parsons was the head of the Department of Sociology at Harvard University for some 35 years. He is the one who created the bar graph, the sociological bar graph, which has generated the concepts of a right winger and a left winger. That all comes from this bar graph. And what he did is he examined tens of thousands of people, and along with his PhD students at Harvard, you know, several hundred thousands of people, asking them questions on issues ranging all the way from what their position was on the death penalty to what their position was with regard to the first strike use of nuclear weapons by the United States, to what their position was on abortion, what their position was on the Equal Rights Amendment, what their positions were on gun control. They asked all of these questions, and what they discovered was that the human family tends to divide ourselves into a group on the extreme right, which he called right systematists, and on the left, a group that they characterized as left systematists. As simple as that. And that inside, just to the inside of each one of them, they had a group called right marginalists and left marginalists. And not surprisingly, middle marginalists. And they began to understand that there were, in fact, two additional schools of thought, which was the classic liberals and conservatives, who constitute left middle marginalists and right middle marginalists. And so that you get this graph that actually sets itself up in the following manner, that you get the division of along this bar graph that they use. You end up with the right systematists, the right middle marginalists, then there's this one, then there is the right middle marginalists, and they go through in this accord, and it turns out that there are seven of them. And it turns out, not coincidentally, they go from the colors they use to designate these are red, orange, yellow, green in the middle, blue, then indigo, and violet. Now, one might note right away that, well, wait a second, those, in fact, are the same as the colors of our rainbow. That somehow light happens to refract into these seven primary colors in our world. And one will also note that they go do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. That there are seven primary notes in the spectrum of sound that we are able to identify. And that, so you begin to suspect that there may be something going on here that has to do with the principles that govern our perceptions of reality as human beings. That we can, in fact, discern just certain types of range of sounds. We can discern just certain vibrational frequencies of light. And in the same sense, we are capable of actually experiencing this set of seven worldviews. And it turns out that this is a function of our physiology. Because, as it turns out, our human family has seven distinct energy centers in our body that you may have heard about, which are the chakras. There are these energy centers at the base of the spine and in the gonads, and in the center just below the solar plexus, in the heart, in the throat, in the center of the forehead, and at the top of the crown chakra. There are seven of these centers, and that they in fact constitute a set of ganglia inside our human species, which in fact generate an energy field with a particular electromagnetic vibrational frequency. and that these energy fields, actually each of them generates an envelope of vibrational frequencies around our human body, and that they are like an egg-shaped energy field around our body, and there are seven of them. And that through the respective energy vibrational fields that surround our body, we actually prism reality that we are able to perceive. And so that these seven worldviews are the traditional worldviews that you hear talked about all the time. And it turns out that there are a set of different beliefs that go into each one of these worldviews. I won't spend an awful lot of time on this, but it's important for us to understand that there is a pillar set of beliefs that go into making up a worldview. Because you would say to yourself, well, when Talcott Parsons discovered that just this inductively, our human family tends to divide ourselves into these seven different groupings or worldviews, you would say, well, what is it that the people that belong to one of these worldviews all have in common? Why is it that they all take the same position on the death penalty? Why is it they all take the same position on the Equal Rights Amendment? Why is it they all take the same position on gun control? Why do they do that? And what they discovered through the research that was done by Dr. Ralph Potter, who was the protege of Talcott Parsons at Harvard University, and who went on to become the head of the Department of Comparative Ethics at Harvard, what they discovered is that there are four fundamental cosmic questions that we as human beings ask ourselves that go to ultimate issues of reality. And that depending upon how a person answers those four questions will determine which of the respective worldviews she or he will actually become adherents to. And these four questions are, and we'll use the technical terms to start with, there's cosmology, which is the judgment or a belief that one has about how the universe came into being. Basically, how did all this get here? Why is there something here rather than nothing? So that this cosmological question that most people do not spend an awful lot of time thinking about, unless someone has put LSD in your tea or something, but the bottom line is that the way in which an individual answers that question will start to guide them into one or another of these worldviews. And then the second question is they call teleology. Now, that's a fancy word for what belief one has about how the universe, once it's in existence, how it is unfolding. Is it moving in any particular direction? Does there seem to be any kind of planned unfolding of the universe toward some particular end or purpose or not? And so that teleological question about whether there exists some discernible arithmetic progression of the unfolding of the universe, and whether you believe it or not, or what direction you believe it's functioning in, is important for your worldviews. And I'll touch very briefly on particular ones in a moment. The third is the ontological question. This has to do with the question of, well, given your judgment about how the physical universe came into existence, and given your belief about how it's unfolding, the question is, how did consciousness come into being? You've got all these rocks and stones and mountains and planets and things all going on. Well, how is it that consciousness, which seems to be the essential experience of each of us, sitting up here behind our eyeballs, kind of looking out onto the world. How did consciousness actually come into existence? Is it some kind of epiphenomenon of the kind of aimless and unpredictable interaction between mass and energy in the universe? Is it got some other purpose involved in it, etc.? How did it come into existence, and what's the nature of it? This is the ontological question. And the fourth of these is what they call the epistemological. The epistemological question. And that question is basically, what are the means that we as human beings have at our disposal by means of which we can possibly gather the data together, by means of which we can answer questions like that? How are we supposed to figure out how the universe came into existence, or how it's unfolding, how consciousness came into existence? Are we restricted, for example, to just the data that we take in through our five human senses of touch and taste and sight and smell? Is this all, in that we process them through our intellect and we kind of rearrange them and come up with some kind of judgments? Is that all? Are we limited to just that? And therefore, if we can't see something, does it exist? These are the epistemological. This is the epistemological question. So that these are the four basic, what they call pillar questions. Pillar questions that go in, because that if in fact, and I don't want to dwell on this, I want to go quickly through this, that if in fact a given person answers all four of those questions in a way in which the answers that they come up with are in fact consistent with each of the answers to the other three, so that there's a coherent, internally, self-referentially consistent set of answers to those four questions, it will in fact generate a very specific mode of ethical reasoning. So that when an individual or a community is faced with any given public policy problem, about whether they're going to have the death penalty, whether or not they're going to have women be allowed to vote, whether or not they're going to have equal rights for everybody. These fundamental questions that confront a given individual and a society, the mode of ethical reasoning that one employs, by means of which she or he comes up with an answer to those kind of questions, turns out to be completely dependent upon what the answers are that they provided to these fundamental underlying cosmic questions. Now, if you think about that for a moment, it seems pretty obvious that that would be true. Because if they're saying, well, what ought to be done in a given situation, you would say to yourself, predicated upon what assumptions? And these are the fields of human knowledge that are the four identified fields of human knowledge that are the predicate beliefs upon which a mode of ethical reasoning is generated. And when you apply the particular mode of ethical reasoning that is generated by a given self-referentially, internally consistent set of answers to these four questions, i.e. a worldview, when you apply that particular mode of ethical reasoning to the day-to-day life problems of the world that every individual human being encounters, what you come up with is a philosophy. So that a particular philosophical school is a school of thought which is generated by the application of that particular mode of ethical reasoning that is generic to that particular worldview. Now, this sounds a little abstract right now, and so what I want to do is I want to point out that you can ask yourself, how does this relate to the more real world? And this is the answer that you get. It is this, is that these worldviews, to move them from this abstract concept of right systematist or left systematist, etc., what you move them into the real world, and you discover that pursuant to a particular philosophy will generate, for example, a particular political philosophy. A subset of a philosophy is its political philosophy. Now, this is the one that most of us are quite familiar with, a political philosophy. And what you have at the extreme right is you have authoritarians. An authoritarian in which they believe that one single individual authoritarian person will be in charge, that makes all the decisions and tells everybody else how she or he is supposed to act. And if they don't, then the authoritarian will punish them. And that's a particular political view. And immediately inside of that, the authoritarian is a reactionary. Now you've heard that phrase, oh boy, is he a reactionary. Okay, like George W. Bush or Vice President Cheney. Boy, are they a reactionary. Their whole world is made up of good guys and bad guys, simple black and whites, and that, you know, we just kill all the bad guys and we'll all be okay. And the bad guys are everywhere. And if you don't have one, you better invent one. You know, that type of thing. And so you go from authoritarians to reactionaries to simple conservatives, which is, for example, George Bush Sr., a classic simple conservative. Guys like, you know, the normal people that you run into in the Republican Party, or you used to. So you've got authoritarians, reactionaries, conservatives. Then, of course, you have moderates in the middle. Then you have liberals. Then you have progressives. And then you have utopians. Now, these are categories of political thought that people are generally familiar with, that these are the political philosophies: authoritarianism, reactionarism, conservatism, moderates, liberals, progressives, utopianists, that these are political philosophies. Well, it turns out that there are, in fact, a group of 10 different key beliefs that flow in a worldview. And these are some of them. And so that my point is, to just get out of this thing quickly, is that each of those particular worldviews has its own unique mode of spiritual expression. And that is why you get religious fundamentalists. That's why you get Taoists. That's why you get Catholics. That's why you get Muslims. That's why you get Hindus. That each of those basic world religions is the particular mode of spiritual expression that is absolutely logically, generically derived from that particular worldview. And that worldview is generated by the particular answers to those four cosmic questions. Okay? So what I'm saying here is that it's important to understand that when one says, well, what are the philosophical questions that are raised by an encounter with extraterrestrial intelligence, the particular philosophical question that you ask in response to that is going to be generic to your worldview. And that your worldview has a whole set of these beliefs. So what I am proposing that we do for purposes of this discussion is that what we do is we choose one of those worldviews, which is the seventh paradigm worldview. The seventh paradigm worldview is a classic utopian theist. A theist worldview. Because if you're going to ask theological questions, you might as well be asking them from within a worldview that acknowledges that there is such a thing. And so therefore, what I'm proposing to do as a methodology for our presentation tonight is to look at the seventh paradigm theistic worldview and to see what the questions, what the philosophical and theological questions would be that would be generated to adherence to that particular worldview. Now, I will give honorable mention to the sixth paradigm, natural law worldview, because as you can tell from the movies that you've been watching around here for the last couple nights, and you'll be seeing more of them as the week goes on, and you're going to be hearing a lot more about this particular worldview. This is the quantum worldview. This is the worldview that is being discussed as the new paradigm worldview that is going to replace the old fourth paradigm, scientific, logical, materialist worldview. In that, therefore, this new sixth paradigm quantum worldview is predicated upon all of the discoveries that were made between 1923 and 1926 by Max Planck and all of the other major quantum physicists, and they've discovered that direct human intentionality on an inchoate quantum field will have a disproportionate effect upon the mode in which it manifests itself as either a particle of mass or a wavelength of energy, all of these things. That this is the alleged new paradigm worldview, the quantum worldview, which is the updated version of the classic radical monist worldview, the belief that all is one. Ah, all is one. Aren't we all the same? You know, that worldview. And I don't mean to disparage it, because it's probably the one that's going to end up dominating everything in the next 20 years. But that deserves honorable mention. And of course, we'll have to mention the fourth paradigm worldview, which is the scientific, rational, positivist worldview, the one that is constantly lampooned among us all as the present dominant worldview. That worldview that believes that that there's good guys and bad guys, and that the whole world is made up of a dialectical dynamic, that none of us are able to really discern absolute truth. All we have is our own relative perspective on it, and that generates our thesis. And so therefore, there will be an antithesis that is generated contrary to it. And the only way that we can discern together truth is by having a direct conflict between a thesis and an antithesis, which will clash together and generate a synthesis, which will become its own new operating thesis, which will generate a new antithesis. And we can keep working our way toward the truth, but let's all be really clear within this second dynamic, the second paradigm worldview, that we can never absolutely know truth itself. As Immanuel Kant said, who was the major philosopher of the second paradigm worldview, that it's beyond our scope as human beings, because we are conditioned human beings born into a particular set of conditions, and we are unable to see or experience outside of those conditions that are imposed upon us by our physical makeup. Okay? So that one is requires some sort of honorable mention, okay? And so that's the second paradigm worldview. So the fourth, scientific, logical, positivist worldview, and the second paradigm worldview will be touched upon as we go. So then we move to step five of identifying the particular questions, philosophical and theological, that are generated in response to the discovery of an extraterrestrial civilization from the seventh paradigm worldview. And so that's what I want to do, and then we'll touch upon whether or not there is an additional worldview, a new, non-traditional worldview, a worldview that our human family has not yet discerned. Because one of the things that you will discover is that as you review the entire seven traditional human worldviews, every single one of them shares in common the assumption that our human family is in fact the penultimate manifestation of incarnated consciousness in the whole universe. And so what we've discovered is that every single one of these worldviews shares that belief in common. And so therefore, if in fact we're suddenly confronted by the fact that, well, this isn't true, that it turns out that there is an extraterrestrial, an entirely non-human life form that is not only highly intelligent but highly technologically developed, then in fact that we're discovering that we're going to have some entirely genuinely new worldview, an eighth paradigm worldview that exists outside of the normal spectrum of experience that our human beings have. And that therefore, we're going to have to try to figure out here in the course of our conversation this evening whether or not there is such a new worldview and what its particular assumptions would be with regard to these major pillar questions of cosmology and where consciousness came from, etc. And so that is going to be the methodology that I use of attempting to identify all of these basic beliefs. So let's start on what this presentation is. And as I said, I'm going to be assuming the facts to be those that have been determined by the Library of Congress Congressional Research Service, that there is in fact a better than 90% probability that there are from 2 to 6 at least other highly intelligent civilizations in our own galaxy. And I would refer people to, for those of you who have not reviewed it yet, I would refer you to the 2-volume work by Richard Dolan if you really want to find out kind of the definitive information that is available with regard to the UFO phenomenon. That he has undertaken a masterful work of going through all the Freedom of Information Act documents, gathering all the information from the internal classified documents that are inside the Air Force and Defense Department, Central Intelligence Agency, White House, et cetera, where these issues are discussed. So I would want us to operate upon those facts with regard to the Congressional Research Service, the United States Air Force Academy textbook on physics of the existence of such a civilization, and take as given the factual assumptions that are implied in Richard Dolan's study of all of the discussions that have gone on within our military and intelligence community. So that's where we are right now. And let me give you a brief explanation without having to distract you with all these pictures running around here of why it is that these different worldviews are so important, so we can understand what the questions are we're going to ask here from the seventh paradigm worldview. Let me give you an example. The right systematist worldview, that's the one that exists at the extreme right side of the spectrum, the people who are adherents to the first paradigm worldview believe that from a cosmological point of view, the entire universe began at 1 microsecond of a Big Bang explosion, and that every single ultimately irreducible integer of matter in the entire physical universe all existed prior to that moment in the size of one single integer, the size of a head of a pin. And that it exploded and generated all of the matter that's in the universe, and that every single ultimately irreducible integer of matter in the entire universe is expanding out and away from that particular Big Bang, the site of that Big Bang. And that every single element that's in the entire periodic table, that whether it's 238 of them, 250 of them now, that every single element is progressively disintegrating from its critical mass into its smaller component elements. And that it is doing so at a particular rate of disintegration, which is, in fact, its half-life. It disintegrates into its lower component elements. And at the same time, they're all expanding out and away from each other from the point of the Big Bang. So that ultimately, every single ultimately irreducible integer of matter in the entire physical universe, which is made up of the inchoate quantum fields, will be separate and apart from every other single such entity in the entire physical universe. And at that point, it will just keep going. And that means that there will be no thing in the entire universe. And so that it's ultimately engaged in a process of entropy, of ultimate dissolution into nothingness from the point of origin. Now, as I mentioned, that's a pretty pessimistic view. It doesn't indicate you've got a great future. There may be a lot of time spent in that period. But they believe that that's the teleology. It's all unfolding and spreading out and disappearing like that. That's this teleological view. And its ontological view is that the phenomenon of consciousness is nothing but an absolutely accidental, arbitrary, and capricious interface between mass and energy. It's an epiphenomenon of the particular random encounter of mass and energy, and that we may be well attracted to it and think it's a big deal because we happen to be it. But the fact is, it's just an epiphenomenon that will go away with everything else. And so there's no real future in this. And so therefore, they end up having a mode of ethical analysis which is driven by the principle of immediate maximization of self-indulgent pleasure. Straight pain and pleasure. That when faced with a given choice of things, you choose that option that'll generate the most immediate gratification for yourself. Okay? And that this starts to, it proceeds to the left of setting up different worldviews where they have different beliefs in all of these things. But the seventh paradigm worldview believes that in fact the universe was enfolded into being out of an infinite and eternal sea of consciousness. That there was and always has been and is now and always will be an infinite and eternal sea of absolutely undifferentiated consciousness. And that for some reason, this infinite field of consciousness generated an initial discontinuity, a singularity, which in fact then generated a second singularity, and that then they generated a whole series of these singularities that became inchoate quantum fields that eventually generated the physical universe. And that therefore our physical universe is actually made up of condensed consciousness. And therefore, every single entity in the entire universe has some degree of consciousness in it. And that therefore, we find ourselves on a continuum of consciousness, which in fact is self-reflective. And that's the seventh paradigm worldview. And that's why what we find is that when people are talking about the infinite being, that they believe they're talking about a noun of there being a being, a great being in the sky, and they make it an anthropomorphic being with a male body and a white beard, and that it's an authority figure. But all of that is seen to be nothing more than a metaphor that is designed to mean something to people in a medieval period when kings existed, and they have an understanding of the authority of a king. And so therefore, you come up with characterizing this infinite and eternal sea of unconditioned being as a noun, whereas in fact, it's a verb. In fact, it's a non-transitive verb of being, and that's all that it is, except that for some peculiar reason, it engaged in the activity of generating a singularity and generating our physical universe. Okay? So that this seventh paradigm worldview is fundamentally different from the first paradigm worldview of an ultimately disintegrating universe into nothingness where there is no mode of ethical reasoning other than individual selfishness and the assertion of domination and control. And so I won't waste your time on all the other worldviews, but I would refer you to the 2001 discussion that we had about these. Where you'll probably find it out in the other room in one of the tapes. And it goes over all the different worldviews so that you'll understand those. But let us move then to the discussion of what the specific philosophical and theological questions are that are generated within the seventh paradigm theistic worldview of the traditional worldview of our human family. In light of this experience of encountering an extraterrestrial civilization. First of all, let's distinguish what a philosophical question is from a theological question. A philosophical question is a question that goes to answering the questions as to what is going on ultimately inside the physical boundaries of our physical universe. That is, once the universe is in place and functioning, what are the laws that are functioning inside the universe? What are the laws of action and reaction? How does light function? All of these things, these scientific questions, are fact questions that you ask philosophical questions about. And what the effort of the philosophical endeavor is to attempt to gather together all of the data that you can through the use of your five recognized senses of touch, taste, sight, smell, all that, that you gather all these together, you process them through your intellect, and you come up with an entirely rational explanation pursuant to which you can make judgments about what type of conduct you should engage in, either as an individual or that we should engage in as a collective community, which will maximize the degree of harmony on the part of our actions with the natural forces that are functioning inside the universe, so as to maximize our ability to survive in the great sea of all of this phenomena going on around us. This is the philosophical quest. And it's abbreviated that the philosophical quest is the seeking of the epistemological answer to the great ontological question. And what that means is that there's a fundamental debate going on inside the world of philosophy as to whether or not our human family is confined to just our five senses of being able to gather together information and data to process through our intellect to get answers to these questions, or whether some other faculty exists, a faculty of intuition, a faculty pursuant to which we can come to know through means other than our sight or our smelling or our hearing or seeing, that we can garner information in an immediate experiential manner that we can factor into the calculations of our intellect to determine what it is that's going on. It is an epistemological assumption. It is an assumption about a means that we have at our disposal, which is not generally recognized, by means of which we can gather data. Okay, so that's the epistemological assumption, seeking the answer to the ontological question, which is, what is the nature of this consciousness and being that we experience? And how does our being relate to some infinite and eternal sea of being that pre-existed our physical universe and ostensibly continues after our physical universe? But once you cross over the boundaries of what's going on inside our physical universe to pursue the philosophical quest, once you start to ask questions about what existed before the initial singularity, and why did the initial singularity get generated by the infinite and eternal sea of consciousness? And is there going to be an end to our physical universe? And what happens after our physical universe is done? Those are theological questions. But the unique aspect of theology is that it's attempting to apply the rigor of the intellect to analyzing the data that one gets, even if in fact one is employing the intuitive faculty to supplement the information that you're using as your source of analysis. So that the philosophical quest is confined to asking questions, fundamental questions, about what's going on inside the physical universe to determine how it is that we can comport our conduct in a way that is most advantageous to our continued living in the universe in our physical state of incarnation. The theological question is, how do we in fact decide how to comport our conduct in such a way as to maximize the probabilities that we will have continued consciousness and continued being even after our particular physical incarnation is over, and even after the physical incarnation of our universe is over? And those are theological questions. And so the question is, what are the philosophical and theological questions that in fact are going to be generated by this discovery that we make of the another extraterrestrial civilization? And here they are. This is the bottom line part where you get out your pencils and paper to say what are these. Okay, so the questions are the initial question that we ask ourselves in the normal traditional philosophies are, you know, how did our physical universe get here, and how long has it been here, etc. That the first philosophical question that we're going to really ask ourselves upon encountering an extraterrestrial civilization is basically to say, wait a second, does this mean that we are no longer the penultimate consciousness in all the universe. Does this mean that we are no longer on the pyramid of the basic chain of evolution of all material life in the universe? Does this mean that we've somehow been displaced as the person, as the being at the pinnacle of this experience? Okay, now, if in fact they exist, we're going to ask ourselves is, well, wait a second, are they more advanced or more evolved than we are? Now, this obviously entails the question as to how we found out about them. Now, if they land in your backyard in a UFO, I mean, you're going to basically tell yourself that, well, they seem to be a little bit more advanced technologically than we are, and we might therefore assume that they may be a little more intelligent than we are. And so that we're going to ask ourselves, if they're more intelligent than we are, what other effects might have occurred to them because of this longer evolution? And so we begin to ask ourselves, well, okay, given that question as to how advanced they may be with regard to other capacities they may have, we're going to ask ourselves some basic questions of what am I going to say to them? You know, what do I say to a being like this? You know, do I basically speak and reveal the fact that I'm stupid and ignorant and so much more inferior to them that they may end up eating me for dinner, like a wild boar or something? How do we act and respond in response to them philosophically? So what are we going to tell them about ourselves? Are we going to sit them down and say, oh, here, let me explain to you about all of our different worldviews? Are we going to be able to tell them that we have the slightest idea what a chakra is? Do we know about that? I mean, what is the state of our knowledge as a human family about this matter? From the perspective of what particular worldview are we going to pose our questions to them? Now, so this becomes, in a certain sense, a political matter, because the question is, pursuant to what processes are we going to collectively as a human family make our decision as to what questions we're going to ask them or how we're going to process the information that we get from them? Now, obviously, as I say, if you're driving down an old country road somewhere in New Hampshire and you happen to see one of these land in a field and you go out and you meet them, the question is immediately upon you and that you get to make that decision. On the other hand, if we're going to try to do this collectively somehow, it becomes a political question as to how we're going to take into account all of the different worldviews, all the different kind of questions that people would want to have asked, and how we're going to pose these questions to them. And so you ask yourself the question right off, are you going to be happy having our United States Congress draft these questions? Do you think they would be able to draft even one question and come to agreement on it? You know, or are we going to have Barack Obama be able to make this decision for us and have, you know, 40% of the people in the country, you know, jump up and down and scream and holler and go out and get tea bags, you know, and start screaming and hollering and organizing against him being allowed to do this? So there's a political question that we have here that's immediately posed to us as to how we're going to go about asking these questions and what questions to ask and how to process the information that's being given to them. What we suspect at this point, of course, is that that political question has been answered by the governing forces on our planet, and they have, in fact, concealed the information from us. And that whatever the information of communication back and forth between themselves and this extraterrestrial civilization, they have felt completely authorized to keep this information for themselves and try to use the technology to build faster airplanes, to assert their superiority over the Russians or vice versa. And so it's like the old Sufi saying is that when a pickpocket meets a saint, all he sees are his pockets. And so that our world leaders that are part and parcel of a dialectical, confrontational, competitive worldview are going to instantaneously experience these other beings as either a fundamental threat to their sovereignty and control over our planet, or they're going to view them as potentially a great ally to get additional technology so we can use it to cudgel, you know, our latest enemy. And so the response of the extraterrestrial civilization in light of that type of a solicitation on our part is going to probably be to try to withdraw. They should say, look, I don't want to be any part of this thing. You know, if you guys want to beat each other with rocks or develop some new technology to beat up each other with, you know, we don't want to be part of that. But these are questions that we're going to have to ask ourselves. And we're going to ask ourselves, you know, I wonder what they believe about the big questions. What do they know about how the universe came into existence? You know, what do they think about all of that? And philosophically, should we even ask them? Because if we ask them what they think about the answer to all of the big questions, you know, then as soon as they tell us what their answer is, 95% of all the people in the world are going to say, well, I guess that's the answer to that. And I guess they're smarter than we are, so let's all get on board with that answer. And then so the whole process of trying to explore for ourselves is going to go by the boards. So the question would arise is, do you even want to ask them that question? You know, if they offer their own view of it, at least you can be able to say, you know, here they are trying to sell that bill of goods to me. You know, I ought to be able to at least review this something. But if you ask the question and they tell you, there's this whole process by means of which you tend to believe the answer. Or else you wouldn't have asked the question. You've revealed that you don't know the answer. Or else you wouldn't be asking them. You know? And so there's a whole set of these, there's a whole set of these questions that are going to come up to us. For example, if we were to ask them to help us figure out how to solve global warming, are they going to do that for free? Or is he going to sit there and go, well, you know, this takes a lot of time. I have to take a lot of time to figure this out. And, you know, if I was getting some kind of remuneration, I might be able to do a little better job for you, you know, which is going to lead us to the question of, do they have money? You know, or are they a good market for any of our goods? Can we improve our balance of trade, for example, by selling them sneakers or something? Other than Toyotas, there's a whole series of these philosophical questions about who we are. You know, what should we reveal about who we are? How are we going to find out who they really are? What do they think about these big cosmic questions that they've got here? And if they ask us, for example, what do we believe about certain kinds of things? A basic question. Exactly how forthcoming should we be with them? Do we basically just disgorge everything that we know and think and feel and stuff like this and put them into complete control of all of our future destiny? Are we going to trust them implicitly when they come and ask us these kind of questions? Or are we going to be more guarded? Are we going to set up some kind of diplomatic negotiation with them? Whereby they give us a little bit of information, we give them a little bit of information. Now, these are political questions, but they have to do with what particular political worldview you hold. And so how are we going to go about coming to some kind of a resolution among ourselves as members of our human family as to how we're going to answer those kind of questions? Those become political questions, but it's important that they're predicated upon our philosophy that we have. Okay, so these are a series of the questions that we're going to have to ask ourselves, and so in the time that we have remaining, what I want to do is I want to tell you that there's a surprising fact that you may not know. I'm banking on the fact that you don't know, and that is that. This set of questions are not, in fact, new. You know, there's a great assumption that we have that these questions about extraterrestrial intelligence that we have are only very recently brought before us. Whereas in fact, it turns out that this debate has been going on now for some time. It turns out that all the way back in the days of Plato and Aristotle, they were asking this question about, aren't these stars that are up in the sky, aren't they like other suns? And aren't there possibly other planets around there? And don't they have life forms on them? This conversation has been going on for some time. And the fact is that it was in 1227, quite some time ago, 1227, that the bishop, the Catholic bishop of Paris, announced that it was inappropriate for people to assume that there could not be other worlds and not be other intelligent civilizations, because to do so would be placing a limitation upon the creative power of God. Now, that was a statement that was made by Bishop Etienne Tempierre in 1227. And ironically, it's the exact same thing that José Gabriel Funes said back in the press conference, back in November. He said, well, you know, as we've always said in the Catholic Church, to try to assume that there aren't other worlds or other civilizations of intelligent life would be to be placing limitations upon the creative power of God. That's exactly what he said. And it came directly from this particular place. It came from the 1227 condemnation of theological proposition number 32 by the Bishop of Paris. And because he was engaged in a major confrontation at that time with Thomas Aquinas. And Thomas Aquinas was attempting to superimpose upon the Catholic Church, the mystical traditions of the Catholic Church, he was attempting to superimpose upon the mystical traditions the scientific, rational, positivist worldview of Aristotle. And they in fact engaged in this process throughout the entire, as the scientific revolution began, which began at about 1543, is how they designate it. It was in fact the beginning of the scientific revolution, and they marked that with the publication of a certain set of documents. It was Copernicus's document in 1543. There were two of them. Not ironically, one of them had to do with his cosmological assumptions about the Earth not being in the center of the universe, thereby establishing our sun as one of the stars in the universe, therefore giving rise to the supposition that there were other planets in the universe. But the second document was a document that was prepared on the fabric of the human body, attempting to study the human body in a scientific way. And that these two documents were published in 1543, beginning the scientific revolution. And shortly thereafter, the Council of Trent was convened in 1545, and it went on from 1545 to 1563 in the Catholic Church. And remarkably, during all 25 sessions of the Council of Trent, they placed on the altar of the Catholic Church during those masses that were celebrated during the Council of Trent, they placed the Bible and Thomas Aquinas's Summa Theologica side by side. And they eventually declared Thomas Aquinas to be the primate, the primal teacher of theology in Catholic Christianity. And by dint of that process, they basically superimposed upon the theretofore principally mystical world, they superimposed the scientific, rational, logical, positivist, materialist model of the scientific revolution. And the Catholic Church, from that point on, has been involved in conflating what are basically philosophical questions to be asked about what goes on inside the physical universe with questions that are theological in their nature. And therefore, whatever the scientific modality is that they were wedded to, they basically conflated that with their theology. And that's what's created the problems that they had with Galileo. When Galileo Gianardo Bruno. Gianardo Bruno in 1600 published a work in which he asserted that he was convinced that the Earth was in fact not the center of the universe. It was a planet going around the sun, and that there were extraterrestrial beings that lived on the other planets and around the other stars, for which he was promptly burned at the stake by the Catholic Church for crossing them on their scientific theories, because they had conflated them with their theology. And so that particular problem that existed and that exists inside the Catholic Church actually began at that time. And that I'd mentioned before that the Bishop of Paris in 1227 had issued this edict when he was in conflict with Thomas Aquinas, in which the Bishop of Paris asserted that it would be wrong for anyone to assert any type of proposition that placed limitations on the creative power of God, that he was trying to condemn Thomas Aquinas for putting the Aristotelian worldview into place and superimposing it on the Catholic Church. And it took him 200 years for Aquinas to actually rise to the position of being declared soon after the Council of Trent that he was the primal teacher of theology in Western civilization, and functionally replaced the mystical view of reality. So what I want to point out in the last few minutes, 15 minutes or so that we have, what I want to point out is that the principal theological questions that we need to ask as lay people is, what is it about the teachings of the Catholic Christian Church and the other Christian churches and the other modes of spiritual expression of our other six worldviews that in fact is nothing more than a projection out onto the universe of our own human qualities and characteristics of anxiety about whether we're going to die, anxiety about whether we're going to exist after we die, these questions, because the reality is that the fundamental question that resides at the heart of the philosophical quest of the human family, that is trying to determine definitively whether or not we believe collectively that there is a new faculty that our human family has, a faculty by means of which we can directly and experientially encounter the unity, the unified phenomenon that bonds the entire physical cosmos together into one unified and harmonious whole. Because if, in fact, there is a phenomenon that bonds every ultimately irreducible integer of matter together, it's like gravity. They're like gravity waves. And they're like light waves or like sound waves. And that if we are, in fact, and have been over the last several thousands of years, evolving a new faculty by means of which we can directly, experientially engage and encounter this unitive phenomenon of these type of gravity waves, in the same way that our life beings developed sight that could directly and experientially encounter light waves and translate it into data for our brain about our exterior universe, in the same way that we developed sound and hearing of being able to directly experientially encounter the waves of sound and translate them into data, if we have this new faculty evolving, pursuant to which we can directly experientially encounter the bonding phenomenon that bonds the entire universe into a unified harmonic whole, and so that we finally come to a collective answer to that epistemological question about our human family, and we come to the conclusion that there is such a faculty, and this faculty is the faculty by means of which we know not how we're different from everybody else, but how everything is one and the same. That is a different faculty than the intellect. Our intellect comes from the Latin root intellectus. The Latin word intellectus means the ability to distinguish the difference between. And that we as a human family have, for the past several thousand years, prided ourselves as being separate and distinct from all of the rest of the prior evolution of life forms on our planet predicated upon our possession of this faculty of the intellect. That we not only are conscious, but we are conscious of the fact that we're conscious. That's why our species is not Homo sapien. Our species is Homo sapien sapien. That we are the being that knows and knows that we know. And that self-consciousness that we have of feeling ourselves separate and apart from all the rest of the universe, riding around up inside our head, and our being able to distinguish our self from other selves, whether they're conscious or unconscious, rocks and mountains and hills, is in fact our faculty of the intellect. That is what enables us to gather together data and assemble it, and pursuant to our intellect, we can make discovery as to what the arithmetic and algorithmic patterns are that are in the physical universe, so that we can get on top of all this and control them. We can make predictions as to what's going to appear in a series of arithmetically progressive progressions. And that is the source of our intellect, and that for thousands of years, We have prided ourselves. We have, in fact, defined ourselves. We have, in fact, perceived ourselves as being unique from all the rest of created reality by our possession of this unique quality of the intellect. And so, therefore, we're concerned that if we encounter another set of beings from another planet, another star system, who seem to be millions of years in advance of us, perhaps billions of years in advance of us evolutionarily, and we have assumed that our faculty of the intellect has evolved progressively up out of life forms on our planet to us, so that we stand at the pinnacle of the evolution of this intellectual faculty, and it distinguishes us in kind from all other beings, we've got a big problem. If we encounter beings who are so clearly intellectually superior to us and have had another couple billion years of evolution of their intellect, such that they've transgressed the limitations of the speed of light and can transport themselves here, irregardless of time, etc., that we therefore are traumatized, we're stricken with fear that somehow we have lost our place as the primal being in the universe. And this becomes important to us theologically, not only philosophically, but theologically, because we had actually worked up a whole theory that the entire physical universe was created just for us. The infinite and eternal being, the infinite internal and eternal undifferentiated sea of consciousness actually generated the singularity to generate the entire physical universe as a matrix within which we could become manifest. And we could engage in this interesting drama of attempting to discern our own commonality with the rest of the universe and overcome our intellect, which made us perceive ourselves as separate and apart, the actual original sin. That is why human beings are understood to be guilty in the womb of the original sin. Original sin being to experientially perceive ourselves as essentially separate and apart, pursuant to our intellect, which is the other side of the coin of self-consciousness. And if, in fact, we believe that that faculty of the intellect is evolving progressively or teleologically into a higher and higher state, that's why we're afraid that if we encounter someone who, in fact, has this other faculty of intelligence that is vastly superior to ours, that we're all of a sudden relegated to a position like the apes. When we encounter them, it's basically like us going around to in front of them. And what they're doing is they're measuring us and taking our organs and figuring out, how we're doing biologically. And so the question is, so that as long as we continue to adhere to the belief that it is our intellect, our faculty of the intellect, that fundamentally distinguishes us and defines us as a unique species, we are going to be condemned to being an inferior race, an inferior species. And so what we find is that our human family, very adroitly, as we're starting to get more and more and more data coming in about the existence of this extraterrestrial civilization, are engaged in a very interesting and subtle process by means of which we're attempting to shift away from defining our intellect as the most important quality that we have. We're actually pushing ourselves into this new sixth paradigm worldview of saying, well, wait a second. It's not just our intellect. We've got this other faculty. We've got this intuitive faculty by means of which we can directly, immediately, experientially encounter the unitive phenomenon in the entire universe, pursuant to which we can comport our conduct either in harmony or disharmony with that, so as to perfect ourselves as beings of an intuitive nature. And we think they may not have it. Because they seem to be kind of stalking around in their big head intellect, smart, measuring things and doing all this kind of stuff. But we can feel. We can love. We can hate. You know, we can, in fact, you know, give up our own life for another of our own species irrationally. We, in fact, have access to this faculty, you know, completely non-linearly. So that we may well be able to make the argument, we're preparing to make the argument, that in fact, oh yeah, you guys may have it over us intellectually, but we've got this other faculty that leaves us still superior to you. And so that the Catholic Church is basically asking us to get on board, keeping ourselves as the primary being in the universe, so that they can be our church. Okay? And so what they're doing is they're pushing Teilhard de Chardin, and they're, even though they're pretending they're not, pushing Teilhard de Chardin to say, oh, look, we've got this evolutionary process going on, we've got this faculty by means of which we can access the woo-woo sphere, and we're all sitting around here in our meetings championing not only Teilhard de Chardin, for those of us who know about him, but we're also championing this new sixth paradigm and this new intuitive faculty, and we're all feeling terrific about it. And what I'm saying is that that raises a fundamental question. What happens if the faculty of intuition, which we're just being able to develop, that they've got a billion-year lead on us on that one too? And so that, you know, that we're going to play the big trump card, and they're going to go, oh yeah, you know, you got a pair of aces, you know? How about four big kings, you know? And we win and you lose. And so that what we're saying is that we have got to exercise extraordinary subtlety here and come to understand that we have this sixth paradigm championing of this intuitive faculty that we see going on now with the California Institute of Integral Sciences, that Stanislav Grof, and you're probably going to be able to find 50 books, you know, right on the other side of this wall that are all excitedly posturing you and giving you, tendering to you this new worldview. And what I'm saying is that you need to be careful about that, because the intuitive faculty, even at its highest, is being asserted to be able to access only all of the data inside the entire physical universe through a non-linear intuitive experience. Now that's not nothing. I want to be clear about that. I mean, this is pretty amazing to be able to have this particular faculty, and it is superior in a certain way to the intellect, which has to kind of measure things and weigh things and lay them all out and do arithmetic figuring and build computers and all that kind of stuff. It is something we should be happy about. But we could understand that that is, in fact, nothing more than what the seventh paradigm theistic worldview has always been talking about. That's what they've always been talking about. They've never really believed in their own inner sanctums that there's some big white-bearded dude up in the sky that tells us what to do and carves out things in rocks and gives them to Moses. They've never believed that. They believed this other thing, that there is this infinite and eternal sea of consciousness which actually enfolded into being the singularity, but they still maintained that it was done solely for us. And so we're going to get ourselves dislocated doubly by this encounter. Not just removed from the height of the intellectual pyramid, but removed from probably from the intuitive pyramid as well. So the question that arises is, you know, isn't there, in fact, like in the octave? In closing, the fact of the matter is, if you take the seven primary colors that we as human beings are able to discern through our faculty of sight, and you shine them all onto one single spot, it will generate white light. And the tones, the scale of tones that we are able to hear, of pure tones, of the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, it's important to remember that the octave is only closed with the final do. It's do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. It's an eighth position. That's why they call it an octave. So there's an octave of light and there's an octave of sound. And so that there is an eighth worldview. There is a completely non-traditional worldview. It's not an updating of the sixth paradigm radical monist worldview of quantum physics. And it's not a seventh paradigm worldview of really getting it about what theology is really all about, talking about the infinite eternal state of being. There's an eighth paradigm, an eighth worldview, just like there is, in fact, an eighth chakra, which the adepts almost never talk about. But the reality is that the seven energy fields that are generated around our body, each one by each one of the chakras within our body, at the top of this egg of energy, seven-layered field of energy around our body, at the very apex of this, if you reach your hand above your head, at that point right there, there is an eighth chakra that is a non-material chakra that manifests there. And as it turns out, my judgment is the following. My judgment is that this eighth chakra, just like the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, that second do is in fact one full octave in vibrational frequency more rapid than the initial do of the scale. And it is the lowest do, the lower do, of the next octave of sound. In that the eighth paradigm worldview, in the opening of our eighth chakra, I believe is the chakra that is shared with the extraterrestrial civilization. But it is their lowest chakra. For they live in the next octave of vibrational being. And that's the means of communion that we have with them. And that if we can not get deluded into believing that all we have to do is update our sixth paradigm radical monist worldview with quantum physics, even though it's charming and romantic and there's going to be a lot of time and energy spent on that, and that we have to do a lot more than simply update our seventh paradigm theistic worldview to get rid of the kind of nounification of God and the anthropomorphication of God and actually generate an understanding of what they're really talking about, we've got to go to open our eighth chakra. Because by opening the eighth chakra, we are going to be able to have a direct, immediate communion with the extraterrestrial beings. And the extraterrestrial beings exist in this next whole octave of vibrational frequency. And what they have discovered is that they know how to use a rheostat so that they can slow down the vibrational frequency of their being, and they can actually manifest inside our vibrational octave. And that's why they have this kind of mysterious ability that they do, of being able to manifest and unmanifest on the material plane. And it looks like they just kind of pop into being, and they can walk through walls, and they can walk around, and they can do all these things. That my personal opinion is that they are beings of the next octave of vibrational being. Now, the reality is that, as Stephen Hawking has pointed out, there are 12 different dimensions. And we are three-dimensional beings. We are three-dimensional beings as human beings. But we're aware of the fourth dimension of time, and that these beings, the ET beings, are four-dimensional beings. They are beings of the fourth dimension, the full octave of different worldviews that they have inside their state of being. But they're only the fourth
dimension. And there are 12 of them. So all we're going to be able to access is the next octave of being. That's the best we're going to be able to do while we are still human beings. And what's going to happen is we are going to evolve into the next species that is going to be beyond Homo sapiens sapien to be the same species that they are. And as it turns out, that's probably what's going on here, is that they are simply the next manifestation of the material incarnation of consciousness in the material universe in the fourth dimension. And so therefore, from our relative perspective, they are time travelers. They are us in the future of the fourth dimension. And they're able to move in time. That's how it appears to us. They are fourth dimensional beings and come back into our octave of being and leave our octave of being. And they are just the manifestation of consciousness in the material realm at the next vibrational octave of being. And the reality is that when I say they are us only because that root consciousness that abides in them as a separate entity in the universe, a separate singularity or nodule of consciousness, is all the same consciousness. It's all the same consciousness. And so that what we have to look forward to when we pass from this world, if we in fact go through an adequate number of reincarnations so that we are successful in opening up all of our chakras in our in one particular lifespan to the point where we open our eighth chakra, we will then graduate into the next state of being, and that we can in fact manifest on that other star system as a fourth dimensional being of consciousness, and that that is our future into heaven, and that we continue to go into, after that, we progress through that process into the fifth dimension, into the sixth dimension, all the way through the 12 dimensions of being, until in the final analysis, we evolve up into a state of complete undifferentiated consciousness. But the fact of the matter is, this is not going to be accessed through the intellect. It's going to be accessed through our faculty by means of which we get access to this state of being. And all of the wise of our species have told us over and over again that there are certain things that one does. And so that this is not given to us by way of grace, even though it will progressively evolve in evolutionary terms, but we can in fact accelerate this particular experience by attending to our meditation, diets, etc. I'm not telling you anything you don't know, you know, but we have to stop knocking wild animals in the head and tearing off their leg and eating it in order to merit passage into the next vibrational state of being. And that is what's getting ready to happen here. But in fact, it's not going to happen through the sixth paradigm or the seventh paradigm or through the intellect. It's going to happen through the experience of meditation and careful practice in our own lives so that we merit moving into that next octave of being. And that is, in fact, a genuine spiritual faculty. It is not just a biological, simple faculty of being able to access the unit of phenomena in the universe. It is being able to leap into the next state of being, and that's where we're going to encounter the extraterrestrial civilization, because that is us in heaven. Time's up. Now, as I mentioned, if any of you want to contact us, you can get a hold of us here. This is the Romero Institute. This is going to be our new big website, www.romeroinstitute.org in California, and we're going to be gathering at 7:30 tonight out at the end of the hall for people to discuss this, to talk about this theologically, about it philosophically, if you choose to, and we'll be available there from probably 7:30 until 9:30 when the movies are going to be given. Was it 9:35? 8:35. Okay, so we'll be out there for at least an hour or so to be able to talk and answer questions starting at 7:30. But then we'll be there both tonight and tomorrow evening as well. But come to the, I don't want to invade and interfere with the movies for people to see. But if in fact you want to, we're going to be right there. So anybody who wants to come out and take a break and talk with us, we can do that starting at 7:30. We have to go now to the speaker's dinner.
Danny, thank you. Absolutely brilliant. Brilliant.
Thank you.
Guys, we